Okay, folks, we are going to be finishing up the Revolutionary War by looking at the Declaration of Independence and flying all the way through to the Treaty of Paris in 1783. All right, so the Declaration of Independence, it was begun, the writing was begun on June 11, 1776. That's when they realized that they needed to come up with a committee of five men to draw up the declaration, so they had to write it. Thomas Jefferson writes a bulk of this document, but others who were included were Ben Franklin, John Adams, Robert Livingston, and Roger Sherman. July 2nd, Congress voted for independence. July 2nd and 3rd, they debated the Declaration of Independence and they made some changes. And then July 4th, the Declaration of Independence is approved by vote. John Hancock and Charles Thompson are the first two men to sign the Declaration. Most of the other people sign on August 2nd, but July 8th, the Declaration of Independence is proclaimed publicly in Philadelphia. So there you go. There you go with some history of the Declaration of Independence. But what's in it? Some big ideas that are in the Declaration of Independence that you should know. The government is established for the benefit of everybody. All right, that means you and me. All governments, they say, should change when they no longer serve the needs of the people. That is a very controversial thought because that would be promoting revolution and change. Today's society, I don't know if that would definitely fly. Anybody who is governed by a government, they're the ones who should be establishing that government. So if you are a citizen and you're governed by that government, you're the one who should be establishing it. Okay? That means get involved, vote, make some changes, grassroots events, things like that. All right. The colonies, they do intend to become free and independent states. Note that says free and independent states. Not necessarily a nation at this point. All right, they're thinking more like little countries. Some causes behind the Declaration of Independence that you should know about. Common Sense, which is written by Thomas Paine. All right, Thomas Paine wrote this. Basically, the general idea is that England should not be governing America. America is a continent. England is an island. What the heck are we doing listening to this little island? Another cause behind the Declaration of Independence being written is the fact that the Second Continental Congress had the Olive Branch Petition. All right, at the Second Continental Congress, they said, let's raise an army. And then the fact that the king rejects that Olive Branch Petition. And they're like, well, if he's rejecting it, then we have no business being a part with him. So we are going to fight against him. Ideas that you, again, should know about. The government is backed on a social contract. All right. I'm doing this as a repeat. All right. So we can make sure you understand that you need to know this stuff. People are created equally, and you have unalienable rights that cannot be taken away from you, which are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. What happens because of the Declaration of Independence? Well, obviously, battles, but the colonies are now independent. Yay! All right, and sadly for some, it's time to decide which side they will be picking to choose to fight for. All right, if you are going to fight for England or stay loyal to England, you are a Tory. And if you decide to fight for the American colonists, you were a patriot or a revolutionary. All right? Minutemen. These are other names for those who fought for America. The battles. I am not going to go over every single stinking battle here. Just realize that there are Eleven battles there. Notice there is a line between Bunker Hill and Long Island. All right, the Battle of Bunker Hill was fought in 1775. The Battle of Long Island is fought after the Declaration of Independence is signed by a majority of the signers. All right, so that gives you some kind of a context here as to when these battles took place. Make it tell a story. Learn a little bit about these battles. All right, and there's the dates. Believe it or not, Philadelphia did a huge amount of financing in this war. Two men, Robert Morris and Haim Solomon. I encourage you to go over to this Philadelphia sometime and look at some of their work. There is a statue of Haim Solomon near the Bourse, I believe, near Ben Franklin's grave. And Robert Morris is, you can just find a lot about him in Philadelphia. Anyway, so Philly does finance the war. Robert Morris, he successfully raised money, all right, constantly all over America to raise support for George Washington's army. And Haim Solomon, he actually went across the Atlantic Ocean to France. He negotiated loans for the colonies from France. He used his own money to buy food for the colonial armies, and he worked with the colonists, and he used his own fortune for the sake of our country. And it makes you wonder how many rich people today would use their money to help save America, and if we were ever in that kind of a situation. There are also some profiteers who do help finance, and these are all throughout the place, all the colonies. And profiteers, basically, they sell scarce goods for a profit. It's really making money for themselves, but they're making business happen. All right, they're kind of like pirates. So, yay, but yeah, they're still bad. All right. The minorities in the war, things, people that you should know or at least hear about. Women. All right, women do serve in this military. All right, Betsy Ross. Yes, she did the whole flag, but like women like her, many wives decide to stay at home and manage the business or the shop or the farm. Abigail Adams, you know, she stayed on the farm and helped take care of things there. The Daughters of Liberty. This is the counterpart to the Sons of Liberty that we talked about in the last slide video. Anyway, they made ammunition from their household silver or pewter or even lead, if they had any. They would melt the stuff down and make musket balls. And then we have individual women who followed their men to the battlefield. Some even pretended to be men and served in the military. Mary Ludwig, also known as Molly Pitcher, she served at the Battle of Monmouth after her husband was knocked down. He was a cannon. He worked at the cannon with the cannons. And he was knocked down, knocked out, and Mary Ludwig came around to help take over his position. And the reason why we call her Molly Pitcher is most of the women were called Molly Pitcher. It's not necessarily their name, it's a command. Pretend there is a comma in between the word Molly and Pitcher. They needed a pitcher of water to help cool down the equipment and things like that. So they all called them Molly because of the common name and pitcher. All right. So give me a pitcher of water. And then there's Deborah Sampson, who actually dressed up like a man and served in the Revolutionary Army. African Americans, their role in the war, thousands of them do escape and join the British cause. More join the Native American tribes and go out west. And then about 5,000 actually serve in the Continental Army with the hopes that they would be freed after they have served. In 1783, we do have the end of our war. The Treaty of Paris is signed. The last battle was fought in 1781, and it takes 2 years to come up with this Treaty of Paris. Once again, we have two more men, Ben Franklin and John Adams, who, you know, we heard about earlier, who go to France to negotiate this treaty along with John Jay. And they do come up with a treaty. The basics are that we receive all land east of the Mississippi River, which is really kind of ironic because that's what we wanted after the Treaty of Paris of 1763, but England decided to give that land over to the Native Americans, if you remember that, the Proclamation of 1763. Two islands off of Newfoundland for fishing. We are allowed to use them, and it was a big bonus for the fishing industry. And the fact that Britain now has to acknowledge us as a country. Britain, believe it or not, at the end of this war, gets to collect the debt. Yes, I said they get to collect the debt. The whole reason why the war was fought was because England had a debt and they placed these taxes on us. And now at the end of the war, they're like, yeah, so what about that debt? And we're like, oh, yeah, we'll pay. And let's see if there's a next slide. If there's not, then I think that's it.